I asked, all right, I said, you think I should play? They won't understand the words. But that song is still in existence, and so is that psalm, and so they still use it today. Now, if they knew it today, they knew it then.
Yes. Yes.
And it was a pivot point, because Christ said, it is done. In other words, Psalm 22 and all the psalms and all the recognition he got from those that were to speak about him, Habakkuk and all the rest of them, he had fulfilled these prophecies and he had come to do what he had done. But I still have to think about the loneliness of being hung on that cross. The loneliness and the noise, I cannot imagine the pain and the suffering. It must have felt like that Christ had forsaken us. Because a lot of times we feel like we're on that cross. We have people that do forsake us. There's people that avoid us, and there are people that go against us. And we start to feel really downtrodden. We start to feel like what we thought were friends are no longer friends, because we feel like they have abandoned us.
Amen.
They feel like that we have been misaligned, and we have this empty feeling in our heart that can't be described, but it aches, it hurts. And people go on with their lives, and you're sitting there saying, but what about me? What have I done?
Yeah.
How am I supposed to get on with my life if you have walked away from me?
Yeah.
What am I supposed to do? Well, later on I'm going to tell you what we're supposed to do. I have experienced loneliness in my life. But the worst time, I think, I was in medical intensive care. And it was quite a few years back. And there was a big scare going on in the nation. It's called AIDS and HIV. And as in nursing, I was the next one to get the next patient. I already had one, but I was waiting for the next one. And he was brought in. The gentleman was emaciated, thin, marks all up and down his arm, eyes are sunken in. This was all shallow, gray. And I looked at this guy, and I looked at the chart. It says he's 26 years old, and I thought, this 80-year-old man. You got the right patient here? None of the female nurses want to really know about this next patient, because it came up that he had AIDS. And at the time, we didn't know what we know today. It was, you touch them, if you breathe the same air, you get it. You had that fear, thank God that's gone. But there was this fear that you would contract it somehow, some way. There were all these rumors and stories and defamation of characters and personalities, and nobody of a particular persuasion was immune from it. You were all going to get AIDS. So what am I supposed to do with this patient? And the doctor said, come to care. Which basically means do what is necessary to keep him comfortable. Give him medication for pain and let him die. This young man was scared to death, literally. I sat down and I thought, well, we've got this going, you've got the drips going, you've got the pain on board, are you feeling comfortable? He's literally shaking like this. I said, what's going on? I'm scared, Dad. I'm scared. I don't know what to do. I said, okay. How's it going so far? You're here. You can help do whatever you need to do. And he told the story over a couple of hours of how his partner had done what we call the rolling stop. The car never actually stops, you just get thrown out of the door at slow speed, you get a soft roll of words out there, picks you up. And that's how he was dropped off at the emergency room. His partner just opened the door, out you go, and he got out and fell over, and the car left him. He was picked up by the crew in the emergency room. As I said before, we were not as advanced as we are today. The emergency room staff took the lab people came in, full face mask up, glasses, and big yellow suits. Yes. Like, you know, I don't want to touch this man. I don't want to lay hands on this man. I don't want to even see this man or breathe in the same air because I might catch what he's got. So not only was he abandoned by his partner, but also the caregiving staff and everybody involved. The one person that didn't really worry about it seemed to be the physician. He also came in with a face mask, the mask around the face, plus the full shield, plus the rubber gloves, and the yellow suit. Okay, yeah, we're going to do whatever we can for you. Just relax, we've got you. And then he comes up with my patient. Nurses were happy. I'm so glad you take care of this man. You're so good. I mean, I felt like I had angel's wings. I was just healing everything and everybody. But this last man's last wish, and he's got me. Long story short, the gentleman passed at 4 o'clock in the morning. I'd had him since 9 p.m. the day before. I found out that he was a church-going choir member. His parents, when they found out he was a homosexual with this disease, they asked him to leave the house. The choir basically asked him to leave the church. Everywhere he went, he had been shunned and abandoned. He had been thrown to the curb. And here he was on his last day. After hearing this, I said, okay, I understand. What can I do to you? And he said, I'm afraid of dying because I think I'm going to hell. He said, my God has abandoned me. Reliving this right now. As a Christian, hearing somebody say, so close to death, that they feel their God had abandoned them. I called pastoral care. I said, I want a Bible. How soon can you get it here? A little nun came up with the Bible. Here it is. I said, thank you. So I went through the Bible, and we read Psalms 22. And here was this man, all you could see with his teeth clenched up, shaking. Here. And as we went through Psalms 22 together, we got to the point where he could actually understand that maybe God hadn't abandoned him. And we looked and we read in 26 on, it really made an impact on it. I'm going to read it to you. The afflicted will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him will praise the Lord. Let your heart live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. And all the families of the nations will worship before you. For the kingdom is the Lord's, and he rules over the nations. And all the prosperousness of the earth will be worship. All those that will go down to the dust and bow before him. Even he who cannot keep his soul alive. Prosperity will serve him. It will be told of the Lord coming generation. They will come and will declare his righteousness. To a people who will be born that he has performed. He said, what does that mean? I said, Jesus still loves you. You are still one of his own. He is still waiting for you with open arms. How can you tell anybody that Jesus doesn't love them? How can you tell anybody that as a human being you feel that they are not up to par? They are not up to what you expect them to be. Well, this gentleman, his name is David, had really gone through what I consider an abandonment of the worst kind. He was told by his church to get out, never darken the door again, to be told by his lover that he didn't want to be known, to be with him anymore. And here he was, looking at me. What are you going to do? Are you going to condemn me too? Right then, I asked, you know, Psalm 22, we went through it a couple of times. He realized that yes, he was okay. When we prayed together in a Catholic hospital, I think it was the only time you can actually pray with somebody and feel that God is present. We prayed, we asked for forgiveness. It wasn't the soul that was condemned. And we read the Bible about what we need to believe and who's supposed to be doing what, and God says, these are the following things I abhor. He's not talking about the soul inside. He's talking about the habits that you get into. And we seem to have a problem. We seem to have a problem with the fact that when we have a situation in hand, we forget about the soul inside and we make blame and anger against the person because of the habit they're indulged in. My God, why have you forsaken me? You can easily say, my dad, my father, why do you shun me? Why, church, do you push me out? Why do you refuse to see me, receive my call? I know that some of us today are going through some pain and suffering because they've lost something in their life that was very near and dear to them. It wasn't the fact that it makes them any worse of a person, it's just the fact that they seem to carry the guilt because they feel the pain of being avoided and the pain of not understanding. But as far as God's concerned, your soul, after you come to Him and said, forgive me for what I sin, I repent of my sin, I want to become clean, I want to be in your presence. I believe that Jesus Christ died for my sins. When you have said that and you believe it, this is the big thing, believing it, not in your head, because a head can be persuaded. The name lunatic comes from Luna. Moon. It's a full moon, you go out and bark at it. I'll try and make light of this because it's a very serious subject. There are people of us today that are in the point of saying, my God, will I ever get through this? Well, guess what? Guess what? There is a passage here for just such a reason. And again, here it is in 22, Psalms 22, verse 5. To you they cried out and were delivered. In you they trusted and were not disappointed. We'll jump down to 7. All who see me sneer at me. They separate with the lip. They wag the head, saying, commit yourself to the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, because he delights in him. My brothers and sisters, you are delivered. That's easy to say, but what do you mean? Don't ever feel that God has abandoned you. The rest of us are sinners, just the same as everybody else.
Amen.
We are drenched in sin.
Amen.
Not from just now, today, but from the past. I guarantee you in the future. Because as soon as you leave these doors and this sound of my voice, you will be tempted again because of who you are and what you are. You feel you are saved, you are saved. So what do we do when people start saying, well, you know, you're okay, but I don't like the way you comb your hair, so get out of here. I mean, people that they really are. What do? How do you pick yourself up? You pick yourself up by picking up your book and going through Psalms. You look at where you've come from and the fact that you are now in the book. You are. It doesn't really matter what psalm, just read the Psalms and start to pray. Because you are God's property.
Yes.
When he formed you in the mud and the clay, you became part of the most expensive piece of real estate you've ever seen in your life, and it's you. Because nobody can take God from you. Nobody can remove you from His graces, from His love, and from His concern. What you do is you stand around and say, praise God, I'm so glad you're against me. I am so glad I make you angry, because I'm not. I praise God.
Yeah.
I am with Jesus. I am with the Lord, and if you can't take this, I worry about you. I worry about you. You know, we've had occasions where people have been against us, my wife and I. My wife has this wonderful thing, she just stands, she says, and who are you again? Perfectly calm. And the person goes, you have defeated the foe. You have removed the pain and the suffering just by such a few words. But you know what? I'm going to equip you a little better. Somebody comes up and gives you a bad time. You say, hallelujah. Praise God. Jesus loves me. You know that? How about you? Where are you with God today? What's going on with your heart? Are you okay? Because, Lord, I'm going to pray for you right now. And you stand there and you pray.
Amen.
You will find that the person falls back. This other one goes, and he leaves. She leaves. They leave. But to win and to gain strength, when you feel like you're abandoned, you praise God.
Amen.
When you feel like there's nothing else in this earth, you praise God. When your children or your parents or a close family member is up against you, you praise God. Because praising God lets you know that there is somebody there that cares, somebody there that wants to bring you closer. Sometimes you feel like God does have you in His right hand. He is holding on to you. Praise God. Because if you feel it, you're there. Even if you can't feel it, you're there. Just trust in God. Praise God. Tell these people, how's your walk with God? You know, feel the Lord smiling on you? Do you really feel the Lord is with you today? What you say? Oh, yes.
Yes, God.
You want me to do what? Praise God. You're going to do what? Praise God. You want me to go where? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm on my way. I'm on my way because I am one step ahead with the Lord. I am one step ahead in the faith in Jesus Christ. I am one step ahead toward heaven, and I am already in the right hands of God. Now, when I stood up here, I didn't know where I was going with it. But I said, my sermon. But you know what? Brother Paul will tell you. Brother Max will tell you. Brother Green will tell you. Don't trust in earthly things. But trust God the Father, God the Son, and then God the Holy Spirit. One is your creator, one is your redeemer, and one is your guide. There is nobody that can stand against you. There's nobody that can stand before you because you are linked arms with God.
Come on.
And as soon as you can turn around, tell the people, thank you, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Nice to see you.
Yeah.
Bring God along with everything we do. Bring God. Sit down and have a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord. Brother Paul's song. What did he say?
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah. And that's what you have to do. You will never be alone again if you praise God. On every time there's a conflict, praise God. You will never feel abandoned. You will never feel alone. You will feel lifted up. You will feel secure. You will feel the loving arms around you. But you'll never feel alone and you'll never be abandoned. In the name of Jesus, I pray.
Amen. Amen.